Hello crew, today we're going to talk about something that everybody's had a chance to see. We're going to try to understand why the sky is blue. Not only blue, we're going to look at why sometimes we see reds and yellows in the sky depending on the conditions. There are really three things that you need to understand in order to truly grasp why the sky is blue. The first is having a good understanding of how light gets from the sun to us and what the geometry is like. The second is understanding white light. The third is called Rayleigh scattering, and this is the fundamental reason for why we have a blue sky. The first thing we want to talk about is how light gets to us from the sun and the geometry associated with that. So here's our Earth. We have a sun that's very far away. It shines light. You all know this, of course. If I try to draw this a little bit more to scale, I can have my tiny little Earth sitting over here, and roughly this would be the scale of the sun. What I'm not demonstrating well in this particular slide is how far away the Earth is from the sun. If I use these two guys here, the distance I'm showing is about 1/100th of the actual distance if this were all to scale. There's a significant point behind that, and that is that we say light that travels to the Earth typically comes in parallel. So all those little light rays are coming in parallel to one another as they hit any different point of the Earth. It would be a different way to say the same thing, that I don't really care if a light ray comes from the bottom rim of the sun or the top edge of the sun or the center of the sun. Essentially, it's all coming from the same place. If I show a foggy little atmosphere here, just so we can get a better look at what's going on, here's the significance of this whole discussion. There are some regions of the Earth, when the light rays come in, that they only have to pass through a very relatively thin portion of the Earth's atmosphere. There are other regions that have to pass through wider widths of the atmosphere because it's coming in at a glancing blow on the Earth. This is crucial for understanding why you would see different colors. And that's actually all I'm after for having us take a look at the geometry for how light gets from the sun to the Earth. Let's take a look at the next topic here, which is looking at white light and additive color. So let's go ahead and start with just a simple white arrow that represents white light. Many of you probably already know that white light is made up of a combination of all different colors of light. We would say that we could talk about the colors of the rainbow here. Those are what you'd be able to split out of a prism from white light. We start with the long wavelengths. Those are the reds. And then on the other end of the spectrum with the short wavelengths, at about 400 nanometers, you've got violet. And the blues are kind of close into that end of things. Remember, a nanometer is a billionth of a meter. Now, that was all a physical side of things, but we need to also make a biological consideration, given that our eyes have three different types of cone cells. Each cell is going to be able to see a different range of wavelengths in this visible spectrum. And from there, we take that and we say that each cone is really best at seeing certain types of color. Namely, we have a cone for red, green, and blue. We call those the primary colors, and we can add the primary colors together in order to get all of the different colors. And so this is additive light. We are adding primary colors. For example, if I take green light and I add to it blue, I get something that we call cyan, which you'll notice is actually a little bit of a sky blue looking thing. Now, in order to demonstrate this even better, I'm going to turn to the place I love to turn to, which is PhET over at the University of Colorado. They have many simulations they've put together to help people understand a wide variety of concepts, and we're specifically going to look at a simulation that is called color vision. Here's the color vision simulation. This little bubble shows what color this little man thinks he's seeing. Right now there are no photons going into his eye, and so he doesn't see anything, and so black is the absence of light. If I turn on red photons that are now shooting into his eye, you can see that he sees red. If I take that off and I shoot in blue photons, now he's going to see blue once those things actually get there. Remember, you do not see color unless the photons actually go into your eyeball. here's the additive part of this whole process. If I add green to the mix, and so you get both of these, this was that something of a sky blue color that I mentioned before, which we actually refer to as cyan. In fact, this is going to be a better approximation of our sky blue, with lots of blue and only a little bit of green. And as you perhaps know, if I go back to giving all of the primary colors, all of those cones are firing, and I'm going to perceive white. Let me go ahead and slide the blue out of the way for a moment, because this is going to be another important one. You see that if I have red and green together, I get yellow. Well, if I skim this green down a little bit, now I'm going to start to get my oranges and start to get a little bit of some of these colors that I might actually start to see at dusk. We are now at a place where we know that if I add different amounts of the primary colors to my eye, I'm going to start to perceive different colors. That's very important. Let's move to the last thing, which is going to help us understand how we can actually separate out different colors of white light. This is a topic called Rayleigh scattering. I'm arbitrarily picking a little bit of red light that's coming in. Our atmosphere is made up of a lot of different molecules, mostly nitrogen and oxygen. However, there are certainly other components in there. It is possible for a photon to get deflected or scattered when it runs into something that's actually significantly smaller than its wavelength. That is referred to as Rayleigh scattering. Back to the importance, though, it can come in, as I'm showing, from left to right, and it can scatter. It might end up going to the top right. It might go this direction. It might go this direction. There's a wide variety. It's pretty random on what direction it's going to actually travel. Recalling that I only detect photons or see color if they go into my eyeball. So if I happen to be down at the bottom right of my slide here, I'm going to be able to see this red photon that's coming in, whereas otherwise it would have just shot right across the screen and it would have never gone into my eye and I would have never detected it. We can put a parameter on this and we can talk about, well, what are the chances that it's going to go into my eyeball even though it was flying off in a different direction to begin with because of Rayleigh scattering? What is the intensity that I would see if I was off down there in that particular location? This is how we describe Rayleigh scattering. There's a more comprehensive equation that can be used to actually show what the intensity would be down there, depending on how dense the atmosphere is, what molecule specifically the light is interacting with, and so on. But what's important is that we can say that the intensity of the light being down there in that corner, it would be proportional to 1 over lambda to the fourth power, lambda being the wavelength. Now, the importance with this is that as the wavelength goes up, you will see that the intensity goes down big time. Because the wavelength is in a denominator, they are inversely related, but the wavelength is raised to the fourth power. So if it is a large number to begin with, that would be red photons, then it's going to get even larger because it's going to the fourth power. If I do some real quick little calculations for us here, just using these three colors that perhaps we're interested in, the primary colors, if I normalize it to red, so you would see one photon there of red if you were sitting in that corner, you would see 2.62 photons if it were green at 550 nanometers, and you would see 5.86 if it were blue. So if I shoot white light in from the left, I'm going to get a lot more blue scattering down towards my eye. That's the take-home message. Red scatters the least, and blue scatters the most. Okay, that's Rayleigh scattering. Now we have all the components we need to start looking at the color business of the sky. Here we are with white light coming in parallel, and I've got my little planet Earth sitting there. I think I want to split this up, though, and let's just look at one region, but let's start with the primary colors. So I'm just focusing up at this one region. I've got the primary colors going in, and I'm going to allow them to just progress across the slide here, but I'm going to allow for scattering. Remember, blue is going to scatter more, and I'm trying to indicate that by showing that it scatters a lot. As some of that blue light and some green's going to scatter too, as those things are scattering, I'm trying to make my little arrows thinner so that you can see the intensity of that light is actually dropping. I get to the end of the slide here and I have a little skinny blue arrow, and I'm showing that that is a very small intensity of blue light that is still making its way that way. In fact, in my picture it goes away, though that's probably over-exaggerated. The green arrow is a little bit thinner than it once was. It's lost some intensity. The red, I only show it scattering once. And these are very rough approximations. But remember, you can scatter in any direction. So we're starting to fill the sky largely with blue light. If my eyeball, if I'm sitting down there and I look out into the sky in that direction, I'm going to see some blue light physically entering my eyeball. And so it's going to start to look kind of blue. If I look off in this way, I'm still going to grab up some blue light that's scattering around. So now I move my eyeball in my picture. I don't have a blue arrow going into my eye, but I want to reinforce that this is an approximation. I'm showing a handful of scattering events, whereas in reality, you've got this happening billions and trillions of times. There will be some blue light available no matter what angle you look at to go into your eyeball. And of course, what happens if I have a lot of blue light that's scattering into my eye, and some green is going to be there too, and perhaps just a little itty bitty bit of red, and here's your sky blue. So now you can see the blue of the sky no matter what direction you look at. What about the reds that you might see in the sky? Let's put a little cloud over there off to the side and look what's hitting this cloud. A bunch of red light and a bunch of green light, because the blue's all been scattered away. If I look in this direction, I'm going to see the blue sky. If I look over off to this side, though, my cloud, this white cloud, is now being illuminated by red and green light. So it's almost like a red and green spotlight are sitting on that cloud. And it's going to illuminate the cloud, and then some of that light's going to go into my eyeball off of the reflection of the cloud. And what will I see? I'll see some reds. Let's just prove that a little bit. Let's put in a bunch of red light, and then some of the green was still around, so let's give it some green. There would probably be a little blue. We shouldn't skimp on it too much. You can see a little bit of an orangish color. If I had a little bit less green in the atmosphere, it's going to look even a little bit more red. With those arrows that I was showing, I was pretty much giving us a picture of a lot of scattering that's happening, because we're taking a very glancing blow on the atmosphere. This is a situation that would be more midday. Light's coming in. It's not going through nearly as thick of a part as of the atmosphere. You're still going to get some light scattered. But if I'm standing down here somewhere, I'm still having pretty much all three colors, all three primary colors, illuminating all the things around me. If I look off to this angle I'm showing, I'm still going to see blue sky, though. If I look that way, that's looking into the sun, you're going to see a little bit of a yellow of the sun, because you've scattered just a smidge of the blue away. And by the way, the sun doesn't necessarily put out exactly equal intensities of red, green, and blue, though those are the ones that our eyes are most sensitive to. If I look up at this cloud that's relatively close, like I said, it's being illuminated by essentially all three of the primary colors, and so it should still look white. So here I am with all three colors going in. Let's take a little bit of the blue out of the picture, and this is starting to get a little bit of a yellow tint to it. I can exaggerate that a little bit for sake of the screen here by taking a little bit more blue out. So there's your yellow. Just serve as a reminder that if I get rid of all of these colors here, if nothing's going into my eye, I perceive black. That's important too. If I think about being on the surface of the moon, where there is no atmosphere, light can still pass through parallel as it's coming into the moon. And if I'm looking that way, I'm going to get some of that white light going straight into my eye with the geometry I'm showing. That means I'm staring at the sun. I'm going to go blind. If I look up this way, no light is going to scatter into my eyeball. No red, no green, no blue, none of it. I have the absence of light. I'm going to see black. So here's your image if you're standing on the surface of the moon. No blue skies. I think we got it. We've covered all of these different topics, and hopefully it makes sense to you that you can think about how Rayleigh scattering can split out reds and blues specifically. That's the most contrast there. Splitting out reds and blues to give you a lot of different colors in the sky. If you think you understand it and you know what's going on, let your computer know.